So section 71A talks about schedule 2, which will be either supply of goods or supply of service. Some example I told you, if I supply goods along with title, then it is sale, supply of goods, yes or no? If I supply you goods without transferring title, title is not given, then supply of service. If I supply title, if I supply goods but title will be transferred in future date, higher purchase, still it is goods. All right, so certain examples are there. In hotel you get goods as well as service, but we have to classify it as a service, yes or no? In work contract, this construction contract, construction service, you give this material plus labor, but still we have to classify it as a service, yes or no? All right, so these activities are there. Some activities are considered as a supply of goods and some activities are considered as supply of service. That we will see in schedule 2. Schedule 3 is given under section 72, yes or no? And yesterday only I told you there are only 3 schedules in my GST law, and all 3 schedules are given in section 7. All right, section 71C have schedule 1, section 71A have schedule 2, and section 72 have schedule 3. Am I clear? All right, schedule 3 is about negative list. Schedule 3 is about what? Negative list. Schedule 3 is about negative list. There are only 5-6 activities in negative list. ECAF is a abbreviation we will create. Services of employee to employer during the course of employment, you know, court fees, constitutional function, hello, all right, this after death rituals, I told you, mortuary and crematorium and transportation of deceased. So certain activities which are not taxable are given in section 7-2, schedule 3. Am I clear? Yes. So this is what, and then we are going to discuss schedules now, okay, schedule 1, schedule 2 and schedule 3. Just brief idea I wanted to give you. Then there is something called section 8 that we have to discuss today. Okay, mixed supply and composite supply. Mixed supply and composite supply, that we will discuss later on. But I wanted to revise one section for sure, and that is section 9. Section 9 is about levy. Section 9 is about levy. And in levy, it is divided into 5 different subsections. Yes or no?
Yes.
All right. Section 9.1, section 9.2, section 9.3, section 9.4 and section 9.5. All right. Section 9.1 is the main levy. All right. It talks about levy is on all intrastate supply of goods or services or both. Valuation shall be done by section 15. All right. Rates will be notified by government on recommendation of council, not exceeding 20%. It should be collected in the manner prescribed. All right, and last one was it should be paid by taxable person. Am I clear? That is 9.1. 9.2 talks about there are 5 petroleum products on which there will be levy of GST with effective date. Such date will be notified by government on recommendation of council. What are those 5 products? Petroleum product, petroleum crude, high speed diesel, motor spirit, natural gas, aviation turbine fuel. Are we clear about this? Okay. Then 9.3 talks about reverse charge mechanism. There are certain activities, supply of goods or services or both, on which government will notify reverse charge mechanism. Under reverse charge mechanism, tax will not be paid by supplier, it will be paid by recipient of the service. Am I clear? That is the reverse charge, RCM, reverse charge mechanism. We have discussed notification number 13. Notification number 13 here, notification number 13/2017 CTR. All right, as per this notification, we have discussed approximately 14 plus, technically 14, but 14 plus services which are covered under reverse charge mechanism. All right, some examples of reverse charge mechanism activities, if you remember, the first was GTA to registered person, so registered person will pay tax. All right, then advocate to business entity will pay tax. Then we are having arbitral tribunal to business entity will pay tax, yes or no? All right, then bank recovery agent to bank, bank will pay tax. Bank ka DSA, direct selling agent to bank, bank will pay tax. Business facilitators, business facilitators, yes, BF to bank, bank will pay. And agent to business correspondent, business correspondent will pay tax. Okay, government to business entity will pay tax. Renting of immobile property to registered person will pay tax. Sponsorship service to body corporate or partnership firm, only body corporate or partnership firm. So body corporate will pay tax, or partnership firm will pay tax. Yes or no? All right. Then 2 points we haven't discussed. That is that landowner who is giving his land or FSI to promoter, so promoter will pay tax. Those points we need to discuss in detail in exemptions. Okay. So certain things like this we had discussed. I hope you understand. Director to company, company will pay tax. A musician to composer to producer or music company, then music company will pay tax. So these are the activities that we have discussed under section 9.3 along with notification number 13/2017. Are you getting this? Yeah. Next point is 9.4. 9.4 is about unregistered to registered entity. Unregistered supplier supplies unregistered entity to registered. Earlier it has very wide scope. Now the scope is narrowed down by putting the latest language. Latest language talks about any supply by unregistered person to specify specify category of person, and that to specified goods and services. That specified goods and services and specified category of person notification has not come. So technically 9.4 is not in effect technically, but the language has changed now. Okay, specified to specified, specified goods and services provided to specified category of person. Okay, so that is also RCM. 9.3, 9.4 both are RCM, reverse charge mechanism. All right, 9.5 is third party charge. We have discussed e-commerce operator, and only three services are there, not many services. Only three services. Which three services? And 9.5 is only on services. Yes. It's not on goods, only on services. Yes. Only three services are there. So one first was passenger transportation by motor cab and all. Alright. Example of that is Ola Uber. Second was, I told you, hotel accommodation. Yes. Through e-commerce operator. Alright. In that there are two situations. Either hotel is registered or hotel is unregistered. If hotel is 5-star, hotel is registered, then hotel only will pay tax. But if hotel is unregistered, then e-commerce operator will pay tax. Yes or no? And third was housekeeping and all. In housekeeping, that security service, cleaning service. Again, two situations. If person is registered, supplier is registered, then supplier will pay tax. If supplier is unregistered, then e-commerce operator will pay tax. Now when e-commerce operator pay tax, if e-commerce operator have physical presence in India, then e-commerce operator will pay. If e-commerce operator doesn't have physical presence in India, then representative may be there, so representative will pay tax. If neither physical presence nor representative, then person appointed by e-commerce operator, they have to appoint person, and then that person will take care of tax compliance. So this is written in 9.5. Am I clear with this? Yes. Alright. With 9.5, when 9 is done, at the same time we have to discuss section 5 of IGST. Section 5 of IGST. Section 5 of IGST is the charging section of IGST. Okay. Everything else is same. 5.1, 5.2, 5.3, 5.4, 5.5. Okay, everything else is same. Only one or two extra line we have written there. Supply, this levy is on supply or which supply? All interstate supply. Which supply is taxable there? All interstate supply of goods or services or both, other than alcoholic liquor for human consumption. So alcoholic liquor for human consumption is not taxable under GST law, because it is taxable under state laws. Am I clear? Yeah. So this is written there. Rate not exceeding, here what is the language in 5.1? Rate not exceeding 40%, because it is integrated tax. It is integrated of CGST and AGST. That's the only difference. All other things are same. Sir, when do you call particular supply as the intrastate supply or particular supply as the interstate supply? Intrastate supply means location of supplier and place of supply. Are you getting this? Location of supplier and place of supply are in same state or same union territory, then it is intrastate supply. If location of supplier and place of supply are in different state, different union territories, or a state and union territory, then this will be called as interstate supply. Interstate supply is defined under section 7 of IGST Act, whereas intrastate supply is defined under section 8 of IGST Act. The point of observation here is that whether inter or intra, both are defined under IGST Act, not under CGST Act. Up to here, am I clear? Yes. Alright. So today we are going to discuss section 7 in more detail, because these three schedule we haven't written and some definition we haven't written yesterday. Alright. So let's start with our first note on first concept on section 7. Okay, technically we are discussing section 7 in much more detail. Okay, listen. Consideration. Consideration is important factor to determine whether particular activity is a supply or not a supply. Yes. In which section it is important? So section 71A and section 71B. In section 71C it is not important because the 71C activities are without consideration. But 71A and 71B, both sections refer to consideration. And therefore we must understand what is consideration. Okay. So consideration can be monetary or non-monetary. Yes or no? You can go to shop and you can give your existing mobile. So I can give my mobile to shopkeeper, this mobile, and I can buy new one. Yes or no? Yes. Alright. So when I gave this mobile, they have given me exchange value 20,000 rupees and they are asking for 25,000 more. So what is the consideration paid by me? On what amount they will charge GST? New mobile. You understood? I gave my old mobile, exchange value they gave me 20,000 and additional 25,000 they took from me. So they will put GST on what amount? 25,000 or 45,000? 45,000. Because 25,000 I paid as a monetary consideration and 20,000 I paid as a non-monetary consideration. Consideration can be monetary as well as non-monetary. Do not consideration is cash. Consideration is not cash. Consideration can be non-monetary form. Yes or no? Yeah. So what is the first point? Consideration, first of all, definition means definition has to be section 2, clause 31. Alright. Payment in money. Consideration usually is payment in money. Usually we don't pay non-monetary. Usually we pay in money. But they say consideration can be in money or otherwise. Or otherwise means? So to explain that, I said money or otherwise means non-monetary. Am I clear? So monetary or non-monetary. Yes or no? Next, when you book your flat, okay, if you stay in rented flat, in Mumbai at least this is the culture, we take deposit, security deposit and rent. Yes or no? So say for example, this classroom we have taken on rent. Classroom, okay, very, I'm not talking about house, because the house is exempt in exemption notification. We are talking about this classroom. We don't own this classroom. We have taken this classroom on rent. All right. So what owner will say? Okay, you give us 1 lakh rupees security deposit and 20,000 rent. So first check that I made for my owner, first check, okay, will be of 1,20,000. Are you getting this? 1 lakh rupees security deposit and 20,000 rent. Yes or no? So out of this 1,20,000, GST should be charged on whole 1,20,000 or only 20,000 or only 1 lakh. GST should be charged on what? What is the consideration? 20. Only 20,000, because my rent is a consideration, no? So GST should be charged only on 20,000, not on security deposit, not on security deposit. So deposits are not consideration. Deposit is not a consideration. Please try to understand. Security deposit is not a consideration. But then what will happen after 11 month, when I am about to vacate my premises, alright. So the deposit they will return, yes or no? Yes. If I vacate my premises, I paid all rent, then they will return my deposits.
Yes.
But if I don't vacate my premises and I did not pay rent also for last 2 months, what my owner will do? Last 2 months I did not pay rent. 20,000 is my rent per month. What he will do? 40,000 he will deduct from my deposits and only 60,000 he will give me.
Yes,
yes or no?
Yes.
Only 60,000 he will return me. So I did not pay rent, so he will adjust the rent. So what has happened? Now he has applied deposit as a consideration. Hello?
Yes.
When deposit by default is not taxable in GST law, but when deposit is applied as a consideration. Hello? Deposit is applied as a consideration, then it will become taxable. Yes or no? So what is the example? You need to remember this. At a time of giving deposit, there won't be GST on security deposit, only on rent. But at a time of taking the deposit back, if my owner adjusts this deposit against the rent as a consideration, then only there will be GST. Yes or no? Alright. Reliance Jio had launch one phone, I guess 3,000 rupees some scheme phone. You know that scheme? You have to deposit, you have to give that deposit. You don't buy phone, you give deposits. Yes or no?
Yes.
Do you understand why?
Yes.
Look at the game. If they sell phone for 3,000 rupees, they have to pay GST. They are not selling phone, they are taking security deposits. Yes or no? And therefore there is no GST on that. So this is a game. We understand law, we read law, and they apply law.
Yes.
Hello? And it's not about one phone and two phone. Jio, no?
Yes.
So transaction is in crores, and in crores of rupees value they haven't paid tax. And have they done anything wrong?
No,
they just understood law. Okay, deposit is not taxable, no? So we will not sell the phone. We will take only security deposit. And I guess after 3 years, some lock-in period is there. If you return the phone, they will give that 3,000 rupees back. Okay? Yes or no? Alright? So some scheme was there. So what I said, deposits can be considered as a consideration or payment only when supplier applies such deposit as a consideration. Understood this wording now? Okay, can I go ahead? Now sometime I don't pay consideration. Okay, I just do certain act. It's like you are a doctor, you treat me. In exchange, I will teach you taxation. Or in exchange, I will do your audit. Hello? Alright, so sometime money value of an act. So I have done certain act as a consideration. Okay, I provided you certain services as a consideration, forbearance of an act, or I haven't done certain activities as a consideration. Kuch karna bhi service hota hai aur kuch nahi karna bhi service hota hai. It's like I'm a lawyer, very famous lawyer. Okay, and there are two disputing parties. You are also famous lawyer. We both are famous advocates. There are two disputing companies, X Limited versus Y Limited. Okay, X Limited came to you. Hello, sir, please take my case. You took a case of X Limited, and you know now that the only tough lawyer in this city is me, the second tough lawyer. So the competitor, the opponent party, will obviously go to me.
Yes.
Alright, so you called me and said, sir, I have accepted case from X Limited. You please don't take case from Y Limited, otherwise it will be tough match. Okay, I don't want to lose the case. Hello?
Yes.
Let him go to any other lawyer. That lawyer I can beat. But I may not be able to beat you, so don't take the case. Now what will I say? Should I take case or should I reject the case? Are you getting this?
Yes.
One advocate is calling and saying to another advocate, don't take the case. Hello? Will I just listen? Ha, okay bro, I will not take the case.
No,
I will ask for some money, no?
Yes.
So that lawyer is saying, sir, even if you take the case, you will earn 30-40 lakh out of it. I will give you 50 lakh. More than what you can earn by taking the case, you can earn by not taking the case.
Yes,
yes or no?
Yes.
Then what's the problem in that? I will simply go ahead with this.
Yes.
Now, am I providing any services?
No.
I am providing services of not doing something.
Yes.
I'm providing services of... Am I charging money for that?
Yes.
So doing something is also a... activity, and not doing something is also an activity. And if you charge consideration for even not doing an act, for forbidding an act, hello, still there is a consideration. Consideration involved, that will be considered as a consideration, and there will be tax on it. Yes or no?
Yes.
Okay, so can I go ahead?
Yes.
Yeah, but one thing is for sure, government subsidy can never be considered as consideration. So Bharat Petroleum or Hindustan Petroleum is giving us that cylinder, 14 kg, 15 kg cylinder, yes or no, gas cylinders for domestic consumptions. Now, you must be knowing the price of that cylinder is around 1000 rupees or 900 rupees, but we get it around 500 to 600 rupees.
Yes.
That means 300, 400 rupees is given by whom?
Government.
Government to whom? Bharat Petroleum. So Bharat Petroleum is asking us, should I charge GST on 600 rupees? That is consideration paid by consumer. Or my selling price, because my selling price is 900 rupees, 300 rupees is given by government.
Yes.
Hello, are you getting this confusion? Or Bharat Petroleum, if Bharat Petroleum is your client, then he will, obviously it will ask this question. Alright, sir, should we charge GST on 900 rupees, which is the actual consideration, but 300 rupees is paid by central government. What can we do, sir? You tell me. Should we charge GST on 900 or 600? 600, because definition of consideration clearly says subsidy given by government shall not form part of consideration. They wanted to give benefit, no? So subsidy only by government, central government or state government. If subsidy given by holding company or some charitable institution, then you will not subtract this. Okay, only government subsidy we can subtract. In valuation, I will teach you this point again. Okay, so tomorrow if Maharashtra government comes here and says, Maharashtra government, I'm saying, you are teaching CMAs, you are making India better, Hello? Alright. And we should provide these services to more number of students. Then they ask why more number of students are not taking admission. So I said, okay, the cost of CMA is little more as compared to other courses in commerce. So institute itself is charging 20,000 and then our 50,000. So 70,000 is burdensome for student.
Yes.
Hello? So government is saying, central government or state government is saying, okay, 50% of their cost we will fund. Hello? So 35,000 only you take from the student. 35,000 we will charge. We will pay you. Yes or no?
Yes.
Alright. So I am asking then as a consultant to you guys, because central government or state government is paying me 35,000 and you are paying me only 35,000. As a person, my income is 70,000. I should pay tax on how much?
35,000.
Only 35,000, because central government or state government subsidy should not form part of consideration. It is not a part of consideration. Am I clear?
Yes.
But if the same activity done by your institute, CMA institute comes here and says, sir, you are teaching excellently well to students, you are making our institute members strong, okay, and therefore 50% of their academic fees will be paid by us. Now that cannot be subtracted. Some charitable institution is there. Okay, some Jain temple or some temple is there, who's coming here? Okay, these are very good children, they are from little lower background. 20,000 fees we will pay. Shall we subtract that?
No.
No, only subsidy given by central government or state government need to be subtracted. In valuation, this point will come again, so you will understand better there in valuation. Valuation means section 15. Valuation means section 15. We'll reach there in valuation. Can I go ahead? Yeah. So this was our concept one. Then there is a concept two. Okay, concept 2 was a taxable person. We have discussed this 2-3 times. Taxable person in law means person who is registered under GST or person who is liable to be registered in GST. So who is liable to be registered under GST, for that we need to understand section 22 and section 24 from registration chapter that we haven't touched till now. Okay, so person who is liable to be registered. Then there is a concept number 3. Concept number 3 talks about deemed supply. Alright, deemed supply is given under section 71C schedule 1. 71C schedule 1. Now it is, why is it particular activity is called as the deemed supply? For that you need to understand whole background of GST, and we have discussed that in lecture 1. Whenever a transaction is happening in B2B level, B2B means business to business level. Okay, whenever I purchase goods, I am happy because I will be having tax invoice with me. Yes or no?
Yes.
So what is my tax invoice? This is tax invoice. And what is the job of tax invoice? There will be value of goods, say for example 1,000 rupees. And on that we have paid GST maybe 180 rupees. Alright, so total amount I have paid 1180. But I know my cost is not 1180. My cost is only 1,000 rupees, because 180 is available as the input tax credit. Now why the hell government have given me input tax credit? Because government assume I will sell, Ram Patil will sell this particular goods at 1500 in future, and when he sells at 1500 in future, there will be some tax amount, okay, maybe 270 rupees, let us assume, okay, 270 rupees will be a tax amount, and because the 270 rupees Ram Patil is liable to pay, okay, he should not be paying 270 rupees, he should pay only, come on tell me, 270 minus 180, he should pay only 90 rupees, and 90 rupees is the value tax on value addition done by him, that is 500 rupees into 18%. Am I clear?
Yes.
Hello, are you getting this?
Yes.
So this should happen, no? Therefore ITC was given. Therefore ITC was given. Again, I am repeating my sentence. If there is a tax on output, then only you are eligible for input credit.
Yes.
If there is a tax on your output, then only you should take input tax credit. You people have never claimed input tax credit. You people don't claim input tax credit. Why? Because you are not doing any business activity on which there is a tax on output. Yes or no? Alright. So if there is no tax on output, how can I claim input tax credit? Yes or no? Alright. If there is a tax on output, then only I can claim input tax credit. Okay. Now what has happened? I purchased the goods, hello, I purchased these goods and I took it for personal consumption. I took it for? I am B2B person, I am registered person, but these goods I am going to take for personal consumption. Do you think I should get input tax credit?
No.
I will give you a very simple example. I purchased this laptop for office use. Should I get ITC on this?
Yes.
Yes. I purchase 1 laptop for my personal use.
No.
I will not get input tax credit. But what people will do in business? People are liars, no?
Yes.
What people will do in business? Come on, tell me. Tell me, no. Say for example, there is one friend. Okay, Chiju. Okay, you take Chiju as my friend. Alright. And he wanted a laptop. Okay. He searched on Amazon or, you know, some shop, Chroma or he went there. The shopkeeper said, okay, sir, your laptop is 50,000 plus 50,000 plus 10,000 GST. Random numbers. 50,000 plus. So he has to pay how much? 60,000. If Chiju goes there and buy laptop for 60,000, for him cost is 60,000. Why? He will not get input tax
credit.
Like you people. You people also don't get input tax credit. Tomorrow you also wanted to purchase mobile. You will not, you will pay GST, but you will not get input tax credit. So what brain you will apply? You will come to me. Ram sir, you are registered under GST. No, I said yes. Then you will say, sir, will you please purchase one mobile for me? I said no. Sir, but you will get input tax credit. No. Then I said, okay, I will purchase.
Yes.
Hello. So I will purchase on my account and then what will happen? I will take input tax credit, but I'm not going to use that in my business or I'm not going to sell it in my business. Yes or no? Alright. So in this whole transaction, government is losing money. Yes or no?
Yes.
Government gave you input tax credit with a hope. What hope? That there will be tax on your output. There will be tax on your output. But you shameless, you are not charging tax on your output. Therefore, we have to reverse your input tax credit. We have to reverse your
input tax.
That's the purpose of section 71C. This is the purpose of section 71C. Okay? Hello. The purpose of 71C is to reverse this particular input tax credit. If you are not eligible to claim input tax credit but still you have taken input tax credit, then section 71C will take care of it and it will reverse that particular transaction and we will take tax from you on the output even though there is no consideration. Even though there is no. See, you are a religious person, so what has happened, you know, you sell sadis and all. Your business is of selling sadis. Okay, so you bought 10,000 sadis. How many sadis?
10,000.
Because your business is in sadis, will you take this credit?
Yes.
You bought this sadis from manufacturer, will you get the credit?
Yes.
Yes. Out of 7,000, out of 10,000 sadis, you donated 7,000 sadis during the Dasera festival, this Durga Puja festival. 7,000 sadis you donated. What is the problem to government of India? If you donate it, there won't be any consideration.
Yes.
And because there is no consideration, you will not charge GST.
Yes.
But you have taken what?
ITC.
This is the problem. Alright. You donate your sadis from your home. Government doesn't mind it.
Yes.
Why? Because from home you have not taken any input tax credit. If you donate business asset, then only there is a problem. And when I say business asset, means you have taken what?
ITC.
Input tax credit. If you have taken input tax credit and if you are donating that particular item, then only we are having problem. If you donate items without taking ITC, then we don't have any problem.
Yes.
Hello, you need to understand this. Okay, in my house I need sir AC. AC purchase in office is eligible for
ITC.
AC purchase in home is not eligible for ITC. I told you this, yes or no? You understood the law. What manipulation you will do? You wanted AC in your house. What will you do? You will purchase it in
business.
You will show it to be purchased in business. And then from business, you will take it to home. Isn't it a manipulation?
Yes.
That manipulation we have to take care of.
Yes.
Schedule 1 is taking care of all this type of manipulation. Am I clear?
Yes.
Alright. So in schedule 1, okay, although the series is different, okay, still we will try to remember schedule 1 in this manner, pari manner. Okay, there are 4 paras, no? Pari is a Hindi word, a kind of angel and all, whatever it is. Okay, actually it is P-R-A-I. Okay, actual series is P-R-A-I. Permanent transfer of business asset, transaction with related parties, hello, agent to principal, principal to agent. And I is import of service. But to remember, allow me to change the sequence. Okay. Pari. Okay. P-A-R-I. First is permanent transfer of or disposal of business asset. Permanent transfer or disposal of business asset. What is the problem with government of India? Why government is worried about permanent disposal of business asset? Is this? You have taken what?
ITC.
ITC. ITC. And now you are donating your office laptop to some charitable trust.